The director of the Refugee Support Network, Catherine Gladwell, is here. And Catherine, I know you do an awful lot of work. Your charity does an awful lot of work with young people, and you would endorse, therefore, what the committee's been saying.
Yeah, absolutely. I think what the government has done in terms of the resettlement scheme and in terms of leading the way in terms of humanitarian aid to the region is really commendable. But can we do more? Absolutely we can. And it's really imperative that we do, particularly for these very vulnerable children.
Well, just pick apart, I mean, what the government's been saying. And you mentioned it there. A lot of work is being done as close to where the refugees come from initially as possible. A lot of money being put into those camps that huge camps that have been established in Turkey and Lebanon and Jordan and other countries.
Absolutely. And I think that is clearly a very important part of the solution. And we do need more countries to follow the lead of the UK and provide more aid to that region. But a humanitarian emergency that's as complex as the Syria crisis is needs a multifaceted solution, and resettlement and additional help and support for particularly vulnerable children has to be a part of that.
Well, we've got the number of 20,000, obviously not just children, 20,000 that the UK says it will take by 2020. Just in terms of pure numbers, you believe that's not enough?
I think it's important that we do respond to this call to take an additional 3,000 unaccompanied children who are already in Europe. I think we do have the capacity to do that. The 20,000 is a fantastic start, but it is just a start.
And what are some of the individual stories you've been hearing? I mean, people are going to think children, and some of them are very young. How do they actually get that far without, it seems, obviously without any parents, but without any kind of adult help?
Well, the organisation that I work for, Refugee Support Network, provides intensive support to these children when they arrive in the UK. And our team see and hear the stories of these children every day. I mean, I could think of Hussein, who spent 10 days in the fridge compartment of a lorry and now suffers with immense headaches as a result of that. Mariam, who was horribly abused by a people smuggler, as we were hearing earlier. And even Safi, who importantly, and this is large numbers of children, who don't actually start the journey unaccompanied, but who in his case was forced into a separate boat from his mother when leaving Turkey and has never seen her since, despite desperate attempts to trace her.
My goodness me. And of course, one imagines that some parents must, whatever circumstances they find themselves in, let their children go, let them continue, because for whatever reasons they're not able to do so.
Well, you think of Safi's mother, for example. The men and the women were put into separate boats, and as a boy, he was put with the men, so she had to let him go. It was the only way for him to cross that water. We don't know where she is today.
Sounds to me, though, like, you know, 3,000, the extra 3,000 children wouldn't even be enough anyway.
Well, again, like the 20,000, it would be a really good start. And it's a number that I think we do have the capacity to respond well and safely to help these young people get a really good start in life here.
But ideally, more. I mean, you like to see, I mean, we're talking about overall millions of people here.
We are talking about millions of people. We have hundreds of people who have signed up to become educational mentors to help these children with their education when they arrive in the UK. One of our partner organisations has 10,000 people signed up who are interested in fostering a refugee child. So yes, we do have the capacity to do more. But today what we're calling for is for these 3,000 to be resettled from Europe.
Just tell us a bit more about what happens to them in the UK, because there are some worries. I've been reading some stories, not just about Syrians, but you know, there are an awful lot of unaccompanied refugees who come into the United Kingdom, and some of them seem to be disappearing off the radar.
Well, there's always been issues with unaccompanied children going missing. There are people who look to exploit and abuse these children at all stages of their journey, including once in the UK. And what's really important is that these children get placed in families, that they get back into school, and that they're helped to process some of the trauma and the immense violence that they've been exposed to.
But are there enough, I mean, you talk about the fostering, are there enough families, are there enough ready and willing families there to accommodate these extra children?
Well, like I said, there are 10,000 at least families who've signed up to go through the training process to become foster parents. It's important that that's done thoroughly and rigorously. But us and many other organisations have been inundated over the last 6 months with offers of support from the public. We have a waiting list of volunteers now because there are so many people who want to help these children make a fresh start, both in terms of family and in terms of education.
OK, Catherine, thanks very much indeed for talking to us. Catherine Gladwell there from the Refugee Support Network.